So welcome to this presentation this morning. I want to discuss with you a concept in mathematics, which is probability. And I'll give you the scope of probability in terms of what probability entails, types of events, and I will also show you the application of probability in real life situation. So without much ado, let me get started. Now, probability by definition is a branch of mathematics, of course, which deals with the study of likelihoods of event taking place. So in most cases, and we usually have an ability to tell whether events will take place or not, so we are not certain that events will take place. What we use is the measure of likelihood, and which is what mathematics has provided us with. We are able to use numeric values to give us how likely events will take place, and that is what probability is all about. And if you ask any probabilist, will have to tell you that probability falls within a certain range, that is between 0 and 1. And it's that number which, if it's closer to 0 than to 1, then it is telling you that there is low likelihood that that event will take place. And again, if it is closer to 1 than it is to 0, that shows again that the event is highly likely that is going to occur. But in most cases, when you have a probability of 0 or probability of 1, then you're very sure that if it is a 0, then that event will not occur. So it's like you're sure that that event is not going to occur at all. And if you have a probability of 1, then you're sure that that event is going to occur. It's like you're sure. So a probability will range between 0 and 1 and cannot exceed 1. You cannot have a probability of 1.5, 1.6, or a 3 or a 4. That's not making sense, because a probability is like a fraction. And again, you cannot be having a probability less than 0, so that's again, it's not within the range. So we have our numeric value which falls between 0 and 1. That's probability. Now, you can imagine somebody is trying to perform a certain experiment, because probability again will be dealing with the performing of experiments. And once you conduct an experiment, you need to evaluate that experiment, and you look at the number of trials you make vis-a-vis the outcomes you get, and then you have to perform adequate evaluation of how likely a certain outcome is going to be with respect to the number of trials you've made. So I'll give you a situation. Like, you have a coin, just a coin. It has got a tail and a head, right? So if you toss a coin once, you will get either a head or a tail, okay? So if you toss it two times, you will also have another space, which we call probability space. Actually, it is a space that consists of all the conceivable outcomes in that kind of an experiment. So what I mean is that the first time you toss a coin, you either get a head or a tail. Now, if you toss that coin again, you'll either get a head and a head. So the first time head, the second time head, you can either get head, tail. So the first time you get head, the second time you get a tail. And then you can also get tail, then head. So the first time when you toss that coin, you get a tail. And the second time when you toss it, you get a head. Or you can get the first time a head and the second time, I mean, the second time, the first time a tail, and the first time you also got a tail. So tail, tail, head, tail, head, head, and tail, head. And what happens is that as you continue to run more experiments, the sample space widens and becomes big. So you would expect that if I do the tossing at that time, then the sample space will start with the head, 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 tail, and so on. So that's what we call the sample space. Allow me to speak more about types of events. Now, events can either be independent or start with what are independent events. Now, events are said to be independent if the occurrence of one event does not affect the occurrence of the other. And I want to give you an example. When I want to toss a coin to get either a head or a tail, that cannot affect how what I'm going to get when I am, you know, picking a ball from a basket full of different balls which are identical in nature except colors. So my tossing of a coin has nothing or has no effect at all on drawing a ball from this basket. So I may draw a blue ball from a basket and that will not affect what type of outcome I'm going to get when I'm tossing a coin on the other hand. So drawing a ball and tossing a coin, those two events are said to be exclusive events, independent events, if you like, because the two events do not affect each other. When you advance this course, you also study more about the correlation. You'll notice that if two events are independent, their correlation is zero. So there is no correlation, and so the covariance, in other words, is zero, because the association between two events, because now that they are independent, is going to be equal to zero. Now let's look at another situation where you have dependent events. And as the name goes, dependent, so you'll find that the occurrence of one event will actually affect the occurrence of the other. Now, I want to illustrate by a situation where a coin is tossed. When I toss a coin, I either get a tail or a head. But there is no way a tail and a head will show up at the same time. So meaning that the occurrence of a tail will affect the occurrence of a head and vice versa. So that kind of an event is called dependent event. That's not the only situation where dependent events manifest themselves, but you also have other illustrations you can make and will give you a dependent or dependency of events. Now, you can also determine probability by using what we call tree diagram, which is actually a diagram that gives you a clear picture or intuition of how events are perceived and how they are calculated using those branches of those that diagram, right? So you notice that if you add all the probabilities, they will sum to one, right? So for example, I toss a coin if I toss a coin once, I will get either a head or a tail. So that kind of diagram is showing you head and tail. So if I extend further and I want to draw now, I want to toss my coin two times, I will extend my tree so that I have another branch, either get a head, tail. So that again will give you an illustration of what you have. So hope that's making sense. And then you can extend this tree diagram depending on the number of experiments you run. So the higher the number of experiments, the wider, the bigger, the larger the tree diagram. And in our next video, I'll be motivated to show you how you compute now the different probabilities given a problem, right? So meet then. Thank you.